If you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. Martin Luther King. Indeed, times are challenging for the education system today, but we have pledged not to stop. We have pledged to keep moving. With this, on behalf of the Department of English, our Girls Degree College, I welcome you all to this special lecture titled Redefining the Concept of Communication in the Modern World by Dr. Mallika Tripathi. I now request Dr. U. Chaturvedi to deliver her opening note.
Thank you. It's a matter of immense pleasure for me to welcome Dr. Mallika Tripathi, Professor and Head Department of Humanities, Feroz Gandhi Institute of Engineering and Technology, Raebareli. I would like to congratulate Department of English for organizing this lecture on a very appropriate topic. It's blessed to have such a wonderful faculty who takes initiative in doing something for the college and for the students always. And Mallika, I'm very happy to see you here. Thank you everyone, thank you students and all the faculty members. Lots of best wishes.
Thank you, ma'am. I now request Dr. Ranjana Krishna to deliver her welcome note.
Thank you, ma'am. Hello and welcome to our Girls Degree College on this virtual platform. On behalf of the management, staff and students of ours, I extend a warm welcome to dear students and esteemed faculty members from the various colleges and universities who have joined us today. In this virtual seminar room, I do recognize many familiar faces and names. A hearty welcome to you all. In order to strengthen the digital resources, the college has embarked on an ambitious program by starting online special lecture series, covering the topics of the prescribed common syllabus at state universities. In this series, today's lecture is on redefining the concept of communication in the modern world, which is specially designed for the undergraduate students. It is my proud privilege and honor to welcome today's speaker, Dr. Mallika Tripathi. It is with a lot of pride that I take this opportunity to introduce Dr. Tripathi, who is in no way new to our college. Dr. Tripathi did her post-graduation in English literature from this very college in the year 1998. I sincerely hope that you will all enjoy the lecture. With these words, I invite Amna Khan to officially welcome Dr. Tripathi and introduce her to the audience. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. A very good afternoon to Honorable Dr. Tripathi, respected Principal Dr. U. Chaturvedi, members of faculty and students who have joined us today. As George Bernard Shaw has famously said, the single biggest problem in communication is the illusion that it has taken place. The past few decades have witnessed a steep and steady rise in the theories of mass communication. Media has emerged more or less an independent body. Communication has many aspects to its existence and now is a full-fledged field of professional acumen rather than simply being an everyday activity. To enrich our understanding of this very vital professional tool, we have with us Dr. Mallika Tripathi. Dr. Tripathi is an educationist, a freelancer writer with distinguished career of over 17 years, providing communication, excellence, training, and solutions. She is currently professor and head, Department of Humanities at Feroz Gandhi Institute of Engineering and Technology, Raebareli. She has specialization in American literature as a thesis related to comparative study of Ellen Glasgow and Planning Corner, she was highly applauded by Mr. R. K. Khandal, the former Vice Chancellor of APJ Abdul Kalam Technical University, Lucknow, for her poetic creation, I Am a Mentor. She is the ex-Vice President of International Dreiser Society for American Studies, Calcutta. She is a life member of Indian Association for English Studies, the Poetry Society, LTI, and International Society for Linguistics of English. She has numerous national and international papers to her credit and is actively associated with research journals and organizations, their editorial and executive bodies. She has also published a number of poems in international peer-reviewed and refereed journals. Today, she will be enlightening us on redefining the concept of communication in modern world. Thank you. Audience, kindly note that you will ask the questions after the talk. You are requested to send your question in the chat box. The host shall unmute you and you may put forth your query. Thank you. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Tripathi to deliver the talk. Thank you.
Dr. Tripathi, please lead the way.
Good afternoon, everyone. I hope I'm audible to everybody.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I'm really thankful to you all for your kind words, you know. It is actually a matter of pride for me to be the part of this program. I'm really thankful to Dr. Chaturvedi, Dr. Krishna, and Dr. Katiyar, you know, for inviting me on this platform so that I can interact with you all. As you know, that today I'm just going to discuss about communication, which remains to be the part and parcel of our lives. This is something that we can't live without. You know, when we talk about communication, this is like air we breathe in. As soon as you are born, you need to express so many things. You try to find out so many ways, different ways, in order to express your needs and your desires. But as soon as you grow up, you just try to pick up some language from the surroundings, from the environment. Why? Because you are in constant need of communicating your feelings, ideas, and emotions. Now, when we talk about communication, you see that this is something that gives us power. You talk about success, you talk about your childhood, you talk about your siblings, you talk about your relatives. Every time you are supposed to be in the constant process of communicating with people. If you imagine your life without communication, I think you are going to be finished in that way. Why? Because without communication, we cannot live even for a single moment. So this is something that we can't, we can't deny the aura of communication. Basically, when you talk about the politicians or the bureaucrats or, you know, people from different domains, or when you talk about common people, what is supposed to be the common thing among them? The common thing among them is supposed to be the thread of communication that binds them all together. So we have to be very particular when we talk about communication. But nowadays, as the term has been, it has taken a different way. So I really feel this is high time when we need to define or redefine this particular term, right? So I think when we talk about my presentation, I'm just going to focus upon certain things so that maybe it is going to help you out so that to be a better communicator. And of course, along with that, maybe you will be in a position so that to overcome certain fears that you might be going through. So I think let's begin. This is the time to begin the presentation right now. Thank you so much. Now, as you see here, I have written that communication starts with the third alphabet of English language. Now, numerically, this particular number represents the planet Jupiter. Now, when you talk about the Jupiter, this is supposed to be the planet of wealth, wisdom, prosperity. Now, you tell me one thing, who doesn't want to be prosperous? Who doesn't want to be wealthy? Who doesn't want to be successful? But what is the basis of all these things? When we talk about all these factors, the basis of all these factors is supposed to be the communication skills. So this is something that you can't deny, you know. Even when you talk about the ancient time, you must have noticed one thing, that, you know, even the gurus, the teachers, they kept on imparting education to their disciples, even in the absence of, you know, writing and printing technology. Why? Because they simply wanted to help their students to get rid of their ignorance. That was supposed to be really important, rather. When you talk about ancient time, you must notice that people have been, you know, writing on rocks. They have been writing on leaves just to convey their feeling, just to convey their emotions. Now, what I'm trying to tell you over here is that basically there is no end to the process of communication. It is something that goes on. Nothing would ever stop the process of communication, you know. It continued since beginning of the human civilization. Now, when we talk about the modern world, you know, we have a number of channels to convey and store information. In my opinion, if you talk about the progress of the human society, it would have never been possible, you know, without communication skills. I'm not saying this, because I hail from the field of communication. I actually try to emphasize the point that this is supposed to be the significant part of our lives. You know, imagine your success where you have none to share. And if you think about a tragedy where you find no one to console you, what will be your life? If you're going to be confined to the four walls of your house, do you think that you are really going to enjoy that? Definitely the life is supposed to be pathetic in that way. Now, the desire to share, it has given a boom to the social media, which is always supposed to be flooded with the messages, you know, relating to the personal and professional life of people. We are so much into the process of sharing that we don't even hesitate to share our intimate moments. Now, you tell me, if today I'm here on this platform, what is the reason behind it? It is just the need to communicate. So every time, every moment when we see, we just try to analyze our life, we see that every time we are into the process of communication. It is supposed to be a continuous process, basically, you know, that involves speaking, listening, and understanding. Now, when we talk about speaking, you know, that this is supposed to be the ability so that to express yourself. When we talk about listening, you are supposed to be capable enough so that to decode a message, basically. And unless until you are competent enough to decode a message and to give the response, to give the feedback, the process of communication is not supposed to be completed. By the way, when we talk about the origin of communication, as you see, that this word basically originates from the Latin word communicare, which means to share or to impart. Now, do you really feel that this is just the sharing of feelings, emotions, ideas, and knowledge, or something else? Traditionally, it basically refers to the sharing of knowledge, ideas, emotions, and feelings. But when you talk about the modern trend, I think the meaning goes beyond that. This is, there is something else that you need to define, that you need to find out now. So I think this is the time when we really need to understand the real concept of communication, what it actually means, you know. Talking about the types of communication, you see that, it is supposed to be divided into different parts, different segments rather. It is supposed to be, you know, verbal communication, that is supposed to include oral communication or written communication. Then we go for non-verbal communication, that is supposed to include body language, signs, and symbols. Now, when we talk about speaking skills, basically we talk about the oral communication, where you are supposed to interact with the people face to face, right? When you talk about written communication, you have to go for, again, verbal communication, but it is supposed to be something in writing. When you prepare a report, when you go for thesis, when you write a letter, when you prepare a project, every time, even being a student, being a school-going boy or girl, or when you grow up, or when you enter into the professional world, every time you are supposed to be into the process of communication. Okay, so this is something, as we see, that I think nobody can escape this process. Nobody wants to lead an isolated life. Rather, everybody wants to be into this process of communication, right? Rather, it is our need. I won't say that you want to be into the process of communication, but this is something that you can't avoid. You can't ignore, rather. Okay? So when we talk about communication, as I said, the general perception is that this is supposed to be the interaction between two persons, basically, or maybe two or more. But when we talk about the real meaning of communication, you have to see that this is supposed to be far more what we actually interpret. As soon as you speak, you basically give a glimpse of your educational and social background. You just give a reflection of your upbringing. As soon as you start speaking, you unintentionally tell a lot to your people, to your audience, that they might not be aware of beforehand. But as soon as you start speaking, everything is supposed to be clear to them. And that is why we say that you need to polish your communication skills. That is supposed to be really important. Because if you just go like a layman in front of the audience, they are supposed to have, maybe they are supposed to know something that you don't want them to know, rather. Okay? So by the next time, I think whenever you are going to discuss something in public, you have to be very cautious. You have to be very particular, rather. Okay? Now I'll just discuss about some of the misconceptions of communication. Now the very first thing that I have taken in my slide is, I really feel, I don't know, I just, during my, you know, teaching period, I just came across with so many people who had been telling me that they could not speak well. Why? Because they had not been good in English. I'm really surprised, you know. I really feel that you don't need to be fluent in English language in order to be a good speaker. This is supposed to be entirely different, you know. Rather, what you need to have is, you need to have thorough knowledge of your subject. You are supposed to speak and you are supposed to be confident enough to share that knowledge with your audience, irrespective of the fact whether you know, you speak English, Hindi, French, or some other regional language. Now, what you have to remember while you are interacting with your audience is that you should provide you know, some sort of comfort to your audience. They are supposed to feel comfortable with the medium that you are going to choose. Because when we talk about, you know, when we talk about the process of communication, as I have already told you, that you require two or more, maybe, okay? So by the time when you're interacting with other people, you go for a common code of symbols. And what is this common code of symbols? That is supposed to be the language or the medium or the channel that you pick up. So it is not necessary that every time you're going to pick up English only. You might speak any language, but you are supposed to be comfortable with, and of course, at the same time, your audience is supposed to be comfortable with the language that you select to you know, speak in front of them, okay? So if you are under this impression that unless until you are well-versed in English language, you can't be a good speaker, I think this is, means to my, in my opinion, this is not supposed to be true. This is not supposed to be the case, basically. Yeah, but of course, at the same time, I would like to tell you one thing. You know, if you really feel that you are confident in English language, this can be an additional advantage. How come? Because this is supposed to be an international language. This is supposed to be a global language so that, you know, you can connect throughout the world. This is supposed to be a connecting point, basically. But at the same time, don't get panic if you really feel that you are not well versed in English language. What we are looking forward for is your knowledge, your confidence with which you are going to face the audience, okay? So by the next time, you're not supposed to take a backseat just being under impression that I don't know English, so I won't be able to face the audience. Nothing like that. Just try to take a lead. Just try to show the world that you have a spark. Just try to tell everybody that you have got the potential. We are looking forward for that spark, for the potential, for that ability, rather than for a specific language that you focus upon and then you take a backseat because of the same factor, okay? Now, the second thing that I just came across basically is, excuse me, communication is a luxury to be afforded by elite class. Now, how do you think so? So many people come up with this notion also, you know. And I generally find people under this illusion that communication skills are closely related with the elite class, as they can financially afford quality education. But in my opinion, it is not the case. As we see a number of people coming from rural background, coming from humble background, and rising to such a level where one can't even think of. Now, a very good example is our, you know, Honorable Prime Minister. I really consider him to be a very good speaker. Now, what I personally feel that communication skill is something that you can learn over time. You can modify, you can polish your skills, okay? You simply need to have a desire to learn this art of communication. And take my words, you know, nobody can stop you from being an effective communicator. But you have to believe this. You have to understand this. You have to, you know, look at the term from a different perspective rather than relating it to some notions that are going to pull you back. Okay. So I think by the next time, whenever you are there, you need to take a lead. You need to understand that you have potential, you have ability, and you need to reflect in front of the people. Okay. Third thing, I really feel listening and communication are two different aspects. People are of the opinion that listening is supposed to be something different and communication is supposed to be the different aspect of, conversation process. But basically, when we talk about listening and communication, let me tell you one thing very clearly. They are closely connected. They are rather interdependent. You need to be an active listener in order to be a better communicator. Now imagine your classroom situation where you're sitting, you know, your ma'am is delivering a very good lecture, but you're not paying attention to her. What do you think? Will you be able to respond to her by the time when she's going to put forward some questions to you? Of course not, you know. And this process of communication is not supposed to be completed unless until you give some response, you give some feedback. So once you fail in the process of giving your response, why? What is the reason behind it? Because you have not been paying attention to her words. So who is lacking? Your ma'am is lacking or you are lacking? You have to understand, you have to find out the difference basically. So every time, whenever you pay attention, when you are an active listener, that is always going to help you out. You know, I would like to quote Peter Drucker over here. Once he said that the most important thing in communication is hearing what is not being said. That means you are not supposed to be an active listener, but you are supposed to be a good observer as well at the same time. You have to be very focused so that to note down the non-verbal cues, so that to understand the mood of the speaker. You know, through the tone or the pitch or the intonation pattern, there are so many things so that you can read the mind of the speaker. You can better understand whether it is the right time to interact with the person or not. So unless until you are an active listener, unless until you are a good observer, you won't be able to, you know, you won't be able to be an effective communicator as well. But you have to realize all these things. Now, basically, if you really want to comprehend a message, what is really important is that you need to focus on what and how. Now, if you skip relevant things, you might not understand what one intended to convey. And the objective of communication will be defeated, you know. So what I personally tell my students that you are not supposed to be supposed to opt for categorical listening, where you are just going to listen to that part that you really feel that it is going to be useful to you. Otherwise, you're just skipping each and everything. Sometimes, you know, you feel like, I'm the best, I know everything. I don't need to have much more material on this particular topic. You don't pay attention to anybody. You're attending a conference and you feel you are just busy with your own paper only. You are just focused upon your own content rather than, you know, paying attention to other people who are presenting their paper in front of you. But if you're going to pay attention to those people, definitely you are supposed to be benefited by their knowledge, benefited by their work as well. But we skip all these things. Most of the time we are supposed to be busy with our own things. You are supposed to be, you know, busy with your appearance, with your thoughts. You are just lost in the fairy world. So you are not supposed to behave like this. Every time you have to be very attentive. If you really want to be knowledgeable, you have to be attentive. You have to be an active listener. You have to actively participate in the process of communication. And that is supposed to be really important, because once you are going to actively participate in this process of communication, you are the one who is going to be benefited by this. Okay. Now, the next thing that I come across is that people feel that it is an innate quality, so we don't need to work on it. Now, I must say one thing, that of course speaking is a physical ability, you know, that people are born with, everybody is born with rather, leaving some exceptions rather. But do you think that everybody is a good speaker? There's a great difference when we talk about speaking and when we talk about speaking well. These are two entirely different concepts that you have to understand. We understand the fact that nobody is supposed to be a born orator. And one can always work to polish one's communication skills. You might be blessed with the ability to speak, but you are not supposed to be the blessed speaker every time. If you want to be a good speaker, you have to work on it. You have to work on your body language. You have to work on your communication skills. You have to work on your accent, your pitch, your modulation of voice, your nonverbal cues. There are, multiple areas where you need to work if you really want to be a good speaker. So this is something that you have to understand. You have to respect the gift that has been you are supposed to be blessed with. You had been gifted with this ability to speak. How are you going to utilize it? How are you going to polish it? This all depends on you. This is all up to you. Whether you are going to take maximum out of it, or you're just going to waste this ability. So I think this is high time when you need to understand that this communication is still supposed to be an art, and you should have a desire to master this art of communication, all right? So next point that I'm going to discuss over here is, appearance and communication are interconnected. How come? What is your opinion about it? Now, when we talk about appearance, what do you think? You know, people suffer from this sort of notion that if somebody is really beautiful, somebody is really, good looking, they are the one who are going to appeal the audience. People would like to listen to them. Is it true? Is it really true? Let me tell you one thing. In our society, people have certain standards to define beauty. And basically what happens, if you don't match with those standards, we tend to lose confidence. And this is the factor that forces us to believe that nobody wants to listen to me. But let me tell you, let me remind you, this is not the case. This is absolutely wrong. You simply need to be tidy. You simply need to have a smart, sense of dressing rather. You need to be a good communicator. You need to be knowledgeable in order to overcome this barrier. Now, irrespective of your physical appearance that is supposed to be God-gifted, what really matters is your ability to convey your thoughts clearly and effectively. You know, where you can convince and convey and persuade your audience, basically. And remember, nobody is bothered about your dazzling beauty. Nobody is bothered. What they simply, what they're concerned about is your knowledge that you share with them. They are supposed to be concerned about your communication skills, your comfort level, your confidence level with which you are going to share your concept with the audience. Okay? So if you think from that perspective, I really feel that you will never ever lose your confidence by the next time when you're going to face the audience. All right? Talking about moving ahead to the next point, people generally feel they suffer from this notion. Speaking well means, using difficult words. I don't know how far it is true. I'm really surprised, actually, whenever people come and tell me this thing. But actually, I don't agree with this statement. If you talk about the process of communication, this is supposed to be, this is supposed to be the interaction between two persons, first of all, where you encode a message that you need to pass it on to the receiver using some medium, some channel. The other person is supposed to decode the message rather, and then he or she is supposed to give you the feedback so that this process will be completed altogether, right? Now, if I talk about this particular statement that speaking well means using difficult words. Do you really feel that the receiver or the listener will be able to give you some feedback or the response? You know, I personally feel that the beauty of communication lies in simplicity. I don't know, maybe you might agree, you might not agree, but I really feel that you really need to be simple in your language by the time when you're interacting with the people. Let me quote an example. One political leader, he's supposed to be very popular among English speaking people for his ability to use complicated terms with ease. But my question is, if I call someone nincompoop instead of foolish, will it make any difference? The meaning remains to be the same, but the objective of communication will be defeated. If you try to flood your message with too much of complicated terms, too much of jargons, too much of foreign words, do you really feel that the other person is going to appreciate you for that? Of course not. You don't need to complicate your message. You need to be confident enough. You need to be simple enough. You need to simplify your message so that the other person can understand it well, so that the other person can respond to you well. You just imagine, any conference, any seminar, any workshop, any symposium, or even the classroom situation. If people are trying to make the things complicated, do you really feel that they will be able to retain the interest of the audience? Or the audience will be interested in them, in listening to them, if they don't understand anything, if it goes beyond their comprehension power? Nobody will be able, they won't be able to grasp anything. And if they fail to grasp anything, they will definitely lose their interest as well. And as soon as they lose interest, the purpose of communication will be defeated. So every time when you communicate with the people, you have to be very cautious. You have to understand the entire process of communication. What is the objective behind it? Am I here so that to make you not to understand my message? Or am I here to make you understand what I'm saying actually, what I'm conveying actually? So you have to understand the difference between these two notions, I really feel that you need to use such a language or such a diction or such vocabulary that the concept becomes crystal clear to your audience. And then only you're supposed to be an effective communicator. But every time, whenever, we analyze, I have already seen so many people who are into the process of writing, they intentionally work hard to make their writing complicated. They feel that, through this, maybe they're just going to be popular. People are going to appreciate them. But because I hail from the field of communication, my notion, my ideology is supposed to be somehow different. I never ever try to make the things complicated. Rather, I try to make the things simple so that it can be easily understood by my audience, by my people, by my students. And that is supposed to be really important rather. Okay, now the last thing that I have included in my slide is communication means freedom of speech. You must be wondering that, it is supposed to be freedom of speech. What's wrong about it? Communication means freedom of speech. But I really feel that this is the greatest misconception that I have ever come across. People feel that they can speak anything in the name of freedom of speech. This is supposed to be the most misunderstood concept. If we talk about the term, freedom of speech, basically it first appeared in Greek literature. That meant, speaking freely or speaking candidly. But later on, basically it became a tool in the hands of crooks to humiliate other people, to insult other people. To my surprise, if I talk about this freedom of expression, it can only be restricted only if it causes direct and imminent harm. You tell me, what about the mental trauma that one has to go through because of somebody's derogatory remark? What about those who publicly tarnish the image of other people? through the usage of foul language. Why such people are not supposed to be punished, who are going to snatch, you know, one's lifetime respect rather? You just approach to your ma'am, you just approach to somebody, and if he or she is going to, you know, scold publicly, don't you feel that your self-respect is supposed to be hurt at that moment? When you are using such expletives and you know, against some people, what do you think? How are you supposed to react in that way? Don't you think that you are just going to hurt their self-respect rather? Recently, you know, I could see on the electronic media that somebody, you know, made a derogatory remark against a very prestigious and renowned actress. And when there was a lot of hue and cry in the media, they were just trying to defend themselves. Why to speak up something that you need to defend yourself? Why to tarnish the image of other people? Why not to be cautious? Why not to be more cautious rather beforehand? Why don't you think before you speak? Who has given you a right so that to humiliate other people? Is it what we talk about when we talk about communication? This is what you feel, that communication means freedom of speech. You can abuse anyone, you can say anything, you can do anything, whatever you feel like every moment. It is not so. You have to be very dignified. You have to be cultured. You have to understand that as soon as you speak, it is going to reflect your upbringing, your culture, your social and educational background. There are so many factors. So you have to realize this. You have to be very cautious. Even I have seen people, you know, you go for Twitter, you go for any social website, people have started talking any thing, you know, without even respecting the chair of that person. People are losing their respect. Being the teacher of communication, I really consider it to be my responsibility to tell my students, because they are supposed to be the future of the nation. They are not supposed to behave like this. Whatever you say within the four walls of your house, that is supposed to be confined to that particular area. But when you say something on social media, it is supposed to be there on national and international portal. What impression you are going to create? Do you really think that you are going to enjoy, you know, tarnishing your own self, tarnishing your own image, and of course the image of the nation as well on international portal, when you are using such words for anyone? I'm not talking about any particular class. I'm talking about common people. I'm talking about everybody. Can't we respect each and everybody? By the time when we are interacting, by the time when we are communicating our ideas, our thoughts, can't we be more humble? Can't we be more polite when we are talking to people? I really feel that this is high time when we need to understand all these things. Communication does not mean that you are free to speak anything. It is something you are, you know, as soon as you communicate, as soon as you speak publicly, I think you really need to control yourself. You really need to follow the norms of the society. You have to understand. You have to go for an ethical approach rather. Let me tell you, like, if we talk about our generation, we still respect our teachers, our people like anything. We have a lot of respect in us. But when we talk about today's generation, so many times I feel that they gossip like anything, even about their faculty members. What does it mean basically? What are you learning? And what are you reflecting rather? And I think because I come from the same field, I really consider it to be my moral responsibility to tell my students, to tell everybody around, you know, that this is high time we need to be more dignified in our conversation, in our communication. Because if we continue like this, definitely I think we are just going to spoil everything. So I means, you know, it is rather very hurting, you know, whenever I speak on this topic, I really get emotional, a bit emotional rather. It is very hurting. This is something that you have to understand, that you need to be self-disciplined, where you need to respect others' views in the same way as you want them to respect your views. This is vice versa, you know. If you want people to respect you, you have to respect them at the same time. So anyways, I really felt, you know, these are just myths, I think, because that I came across during my teaching career, basically. And I really thought of discussing it with you all so that you can also redefine this term, basically. Okay, now we will switch over to 7 C's of effective communication. The very first thing that I have included over here is content. Now, if you want to be an effective communicator, the very first element I prefer is the content. You know, if you lack in content, you might drastically fail. Even you talk about a very good speaker, they also might get nervous if you ask them to speak on a topic that they are not supposed to be aware of. You need to be thoroughly prepared. You need to collect information from various sources, from multiple sources, to speak on a particular topic. For that purpose, even you can develop the habit of reading, you know, to gain knowledge. Even once you are going to interact with the subject experts or people who have expertise in that particular field, they can also help you out. So as soon as you feel that you are thoroughly prepared, it simply, you know, gives you a sense of confidence. And it becomes quite easy for you so that to express your views in front of the audience, okay? Now, the second thing that I've included over here is clarity. Now, you have content. You've already collected the material from different sources, from various sources. You feel that you're thoroughly prepared. But unless until you have clarity of thought and expression, it is all in vain. Though you have collected the material, but the concept has to be clear to yourself, because unless until you are clear in yourself, you won't be able to convey the same to your audience. So this is supposed to be really important, you know. You must know how to convey your thoughts to other people. And for that purpose, everything needs to be clear to you. You know, so many times, I would like to quote Robert Frost here. You know, he once said, half the world is made of people who have so much to say, but don't know how to say it. And the other half having nothing to say, but keep on saying. So I really hope that you understand this point, basically. You need to focus upon two factors, two elements, that is what and how. Now, what is supposed to be the content that you are going to collect through different sources, and how is supposed to be your style? The way you speak, the way you present your ideas in front of other people, okay? So every time, whenever you just go to face the audience publicly, you have to focus on one thing, that is supposed to be the what and how. If you're just going to club both the things, I think you are going to be a good speaker rather, okay? Third thing that I have included to here is conciseness. Now, you know, if you ask me, what is the most precious thing in the world? My answer will be time. I hope, I don't know whether you agree or not, but time is the most precious factor. You know, you have a lot of things in your mind, you are really feeling painful, you are suffering a lot, and you rush to your ma'am and you want to share so many things, and she is in a hurry, she has to attend a meeting. She will, you know, tell you, okay, you have 5 minutes, just tell me, what do you want? Oh my God. Now you had ample of things to share, you wanted to tell so many things, but you simply got just 5 minutes. Now you, maybe you might approach to somebody else who is, you know, in a higher position. They might simply ask you to, you know, explain everything in 2 minutes. Nowadays, people simply run, you know, they run short of time, basically. Nobody has time. People have everything, but they are running short of time, basically. So in that situation, if you want to be an effective communicator, what is really important is that you need to be as precise as possible. You need to cut short all the irrelevant points while interacting with other people, you know. You need to make things more meaningful. If you talk about the technical era, if you talk about the modern world, you see this is the time of hard disk, CD, pen drive and all. Even where you can carry all that encyclopedia and that pen drive only. So when I talk about yourself as an individual, at least you can also develop this art of speaking. You should have this ability so that to, you know, express yourself within no time. You should try to, you know, extract maximum out of 2 minutes, out of the time that is being allotted to you. Okay, so being concise, being precise, this is supposed to be really important when we talk about, you know, effective communication. Okay, next thing is correctness. Now, basically, when we talk about correctness, let me tell you, in the long run, this is supposed to establish your image as a speaker. If you really wish to maintain your credibility in the professional world, you need to be accurate in your information. Now, basically, when you share, you know, authentic and correct information, people start trusting you, you know, they trust you. You are able to develop a long-term rapport with them. So every time when you come, you know, when you speak publicly, you have to be accurate. You have to be factual. You need to go for that. You are not supposed to be a gossip monger in that way so that you're just going to spread rumors. No. You have to come up with something factual that can be cross-checked, that can be verified. If you really want to establish yourself as a good speaker. So this correctness, this authenticity is supposed to be very important, you know. Now the next thing is coherence. When we talk about coherence, basically what I'm trying to focus upon is that everything is supposed to be interconnected. You don't need to deviate from the main point, from the main idea. You know, when you are interacting with your audience, when you're presenting a paper, when you are, you know, giving a speech, every time, every moment, you need to be, you know, everything need to be coherent. It needs to be connected. If I'm just, you know, discussing 7 C's of effective communication, and all of a sudden, if I switch over to some movie and start narrating the story of that movie, basically, how will you feel then? What has gone wrong with ma'am, you know? What is she talking about? Every time, whenever you speak publicly, you should have a governing theme. You should have a main idea. You should have, you know, main points, and you need to focus upon those points only. One idea should lead to another idea. Okay. So you are supposed to unite each and everything, and then you are supposed to front in front of the public. Okay. Then we go to this completeness. I personally feel that whenever you talk publicly, whenever you write something, whenever you're going to document something, the message is supposed to be complete in all respects. If you leave a point in between, you know, it might spoil your message. Incomplete, you know, messages can be interpreted in a wrong way. For example, if I say, if you don't follow my instructions, I might dash, dash, dash. It may be interpreted as, I might fire you, I might kill you, I might not see your face again in my life. And maybe you simply wanted to say, if you don't follow my instructions, I might fail in my objective. So this is just a simple example to tell you that if you leave the things in between, it can be misinterpreted. It can be misused rather. So every time, whenever you are documenting something, every time when you are talking to people, every time when you are, you know, facing the audience or you are addressing the audience, you need to give a complete message. It should not be left in between. Okay. Then the last point that we talk about is courtesy. Now, let me tell you, you can never ever be an effective communicator if you are not courteous. You need to be very humble. You need to be very polite. You need to be, you know, up to some extent, you need to be submissive as well. But if you talk, you know, who would like to talk to a person who has a harsh tone? If every time, if I'm ready to scold you, if I'm every time you feel that ma'am's too rude, too arrogant, would you like to talk to such people? No. People who are humble, people who are polite, people who are down to earth, they are supposed to be good speakers as well. Why? Because they, you know, they succeed in developing a bond with their listeners. And as soon as you develop with this bond, as soon as you are in a good rapport with your audience, they will respect you. they would like to talk to you more and, you know, again and again rather. So this is something I really feel that you really need to adopt all these things if you really want to be an effective communicator. Okay. Besides, I would like to give you some more tips, you know, to be an effective communicator. I think it's really going to help you out. Okay. So here goes the tips actually. Respect your audience. Basically, whenever you go for public speaking, and if you respect your audience, you know, they will also treat you in the same way. I really tell my students that you're not supposed to doubt the intentions of your audience. You need to be positive. You need to be flexible in your approach. You should not try to impose your ideas on them. Don't try to dominate them. You need to maintain a long-term rapport with your audience. For example, maybe in the process of communication, if you are adamant to win an argument, maybe in the long run, you are going to lose all the relationships. The choice is yours. What do you want actually? If you really respect your audience, if you respect the other person, and if you encourage them to participate in your conversation, I think you are going to build a long-term rapport with them. And I really prefer that it should be a two-way communication. Though here it is not so actually, but I really prefer whenever I'm, you know, I'm facing the audience, I want them to participate. I want them to interact with me. I really need to go for, you know, conversational style, because the audience is supposed to be interested. As soon as they are actively involved in the process of communication, they will enjoy that process basically, okay? And of course, be amicable. You need to be friendly. You need to be polite. You need to be humble, because this is the best way, you know, so that to respect your audience, this is the best way to maintain that long-term rapport. And you are not, let me tell you one thing. You are not supposed to be hostile to anyone, even if they are trying to hurt you or hurt your sentiments. What you can do during the process is that you are supposed to stay calm while dealing with such people. Okay, don't let them spoil your image. Maybe in a fit of anger, if somebody is hurting you, you also might say something else in reaction. I don't know about those people, but definitely you are supposed to be concerned about your own image. That might adversely affect your image. So it's better to be friendly in tone, in body language, and of course in your conversation with other people as well. Okay. Then we say you need to focus on nonverbal cues. As I told you beforehand also, that paying attention to nonverbal cues, actually it will help you to a great extent, you know. It will give you an opportunity to feel the pulse of your audience. And once you feel how your audience feel, even you can change your strategy as per the mood of your audience basically. So in case if you're just going to make the proper use of all these nonverbal cues, you know, it will help you to create an everlasting impression that will enhance your image as a good speaker. Okay. Next thing is you need to be simple and honest. I think simplicity and honesty is the best policy. You always need to be honest in your approach. You are not supposed to befool your audience, you know. Everybody is intelligent enough, they do understand. You can't befool people now, you know. So much is there on Google and all those, you know, social media. If you feel that you are going to, you know, befool people like this, it is practically not possible. You need to be direct, you need to be balanced. And if there comes a point where you don't know something, you need to politely accept it instead of beating about bush. So I think I really appreciate my people if they are simple and if they are honest in their approach towards other people, right? Then you go for, you need to avoid any sort of distractions. By the time when you are, you know, addressing the people, when you are talking to somebody, or maybe when you are there in a classroom, when you are there in a meeting, you have to avoid any sort of distraction that might distract your audience, you know? For example, you know, you are just speaking to somebody and you're constantly playing with your keychain. Do you really feel that your the other person is going to appreciate that? He or she will be distracted. If you're talking to somebody, you're just setting your hair every moment. People are into the habit of all these things. But my humble submission is that every time, whenever you're talking to people, you need to avoid any sort of distraction like this. You are supposed to be very straight, very direct, so that people can focus on your message, rather than focusing on all these activities that you keep on, you know, you continue with. So next time, whenever you try to communicate with somebody, please try to, you know, recall all these points. Okay. Then we say that you need to know your objective. Let me tell you, if we differentiate general and professional communication, let me tell you, whenever we talk about professional communication, it is always supposed to be purpose oriented. You need to have some objective. If I'm sitting here, I'm sitting here with some objective. If you are sitting here listening to me, you have some objective. If I'm going to attend a meeting, if I'm going to present a research paper, every time we are interacting with people with some purpose, with some objective. So before you start addressing the people, please, you need to be clear in your objective itself. You need to know what is the purpose of my presentation, what is the purpose of my speech, what is the objective behind I'm going to present this paper in front of people, what is the objective behind conducting this meeting. So you are supposed to be very much clear in your objective and your purpose before addressing the people. Okay. Then we go for, you know, you need to be empathetic. Now, unless until you put yourself in somebody else's situation, you won't be able to understand their pain. You have to have, you know, you have to be empathetic so that to understand what the other person is going through. If I scold somebody in my class without knowing the reason behind why he or she is not paying attention in my class, do you think that person will respect me later on? I need to find out the reasons. I need to find out what lies behind the curtain. I need to find out what this person is actually going through. It will enhance me, or it will enable me to be more understandable, you know. I'll be more understanding. And definitely, if I'm understanding, I will be in a position to be an effective communicator as well. Okay. Next, I have written, be tactful. Now, you must be wondering, what is tactful? Why are we supposed to be tactful in order to be an effective communicator, basically? Now, let me tell you, you actually need to be tactful while dealing with a tough audience. You know, whenever we, you know, address a group of people, you might find some people whose whole sole objective is to create nuisance. It happens. It generally happens. It is a human psychology. So you need to be, you know, tactful enough to handle those people, to handle their queries. You may borrow some time to answer their queries later on, in case you're not sure about something, you know. You're not supposed to be aggressive, please remember. You're not supposed to react. What you need to do is, you need to be polite, you need to be positive, even towards your negative audience. And that is why, if you want to be an effective communicator, you really need to be tactful at the same time. Okay? And please remember, by the time when you're going to face this sort of people, you are not supposed to turn hostile to them, you know? You should consider them to be your friends. Why? Because in that way, you're supposed to have a positive feel. And once you face them with a positive mindset, definitely, maybe by the next time, or maybe they will realize their mistakes, and later on they will not create that sort of nuisance during your meeting or during your presentation or whatever it is. So every time, you need to be a bit diplomatic also. Everybody is not goody-goody in this world. We have to understand that thing, you know. We are living in a society where we find, you know, God and evil both. We have to deal with them both. So for that purpose, you need to inculcate certain skills. Okay. Then we say, don't be non-judgmental. You know, you're not supposed to be judgmental, rather. Don't judge anyone, you know, at an early stage. You need to take your time so that to form an image of a person. Maybe when you're meeting, though we say, you know, first impression is the last impression, but maybe when you are meeting with somebody, you know, after two or three meetings, maybe your perception about that person is going to be changed. You're not supposed to be biased because of somebody else's opinion. You need to believe yourself. Give some time to your relationship. Give some time to yourself to analyze the true picture of an individual. Then only conclude something. Okay? Then you say you need to communicate through your eyes. I must tell you one thing. You know, eyes are the openings through which, you know, we can peep into the soul of a person. You need to make the maximum use of your eyes while opting for interpersonal communication. If you look straight into the eyes of the listener, it will certainly help you to, you know, develop a friendly rapport with that person. It will reflect your confidence, basically. But when you are looking into the eyes of a person, please remember one thing, you are not supposed to stare. You need to keep on moving. You need to maintain eye-to-eye contact with everybody around you, among the audience, okay? So if you do so, it will definitely enhance your image as a confident speaker, okay? Now, the last thing that I have included in my slide is that you need to know your communication environment. It is very, very essential to know your communication environment. Rather, you should have a prior hand knowledge of your communication environment. Now, you are thoroughly prepared. You have collected all the material. You have practiced and practiced and practiced. You are a very good speaker. But sometimes, because of the poor physical facilities, you drastically fail. Maybe, you know, suppose you have to present a paper. You have carried all your data in a pen drive. And you land up at such a place where there is no facility so that to, you know, present your paper through that pen drive. You don't have your hard copies. What will you do? It's going to be a tough time. Because of that technical failure, so many times it happens with the people. So before you present your ideas, before you address somebody, before you go for public speaking, what is really important is that you need to know the physical surroundings of that particular place so that you are supposed to be prepared accordingly. For example, if you're just going to address, you know, maybe 500 people, and as soon as you reach the stage, you really find that the mic is not working. You get into a fix because you have not actually, not actually checked it beforehand. So these are the things that we need to consider before we go for any sort of public speaking, actually. So I really hope that if you continue, if you focus upon all these points, it will definitely help you to be an effective communicator and, of course, to be a good human being as well. So thank you so much. I'm really thankful to you all for your patient listening. And I really feel that I didn't take too much time. Thanks once again to everybody.
Thank you, Dr. Tripathi, for that very engaging communication on communication and bringing to light the fact that language should not restrict, and it certainly does not define, our communication abilities or communication skills. Bhasha se zyada adhik mahatv aapki baat ke marm ka hai. And this is something that has been so very commonly there in our culture. And before we proceed on to take the questions, I would just like to say a very often quoted quote of a very famous thinker. Aisi vani boliye, man ka aapa khoye, auran ko seetal kare, aapahun seetal hoye. And now I would like to invite Anag to please put forth her question.
May I interrupt and may I say something, if allowed?
Sure, ma'am, please. The floor is
yours.
Thank
you so much, Dr. Mallika. It was really very enlightening and very motivating lecture. Five things I should be saying, I have noted down. And it really, you know, it touches my heart. And I also want to convey the same things to everybody. That is why I'm repeating it with, like, whatever you said, I'm repeating it again. Number one, beauty of communication lies in simplicity. Number two, think before you speak. Number four, be positive to negative people. And last one, you need to be humble. So this is these are the mottos of my life also. So I try to do as much as I can. And of course, I'm learning. So I have learned a lot from you today. And it was really very, very motivating and very nice. Thank you. Thank you so much.
I would like to come in.
Yes, ma'am. Please.
Yeah. Thank you, Mallika. That was really a wonderful, discourse. And I really thank you for taking up this topic, because you see, in college, since English is a second language of our students, most of the time we encounter this problem when students approach teachers, that the sociolinguistic skills are compromised somewhere, and they need to put in more effort in knowing how to speak, when to speak, and to whom to speak in that particular manner. So I believe the students would have learned a lot from your presentation. At the same time, I would also like to say, you know, as Newton has said, that every action has an equal and opposite reaction. So when you utter a thought, you actually set a ball rolling. So the kind of thoughts you send out into the world, the same kind of thoughts would revert to you. And the same applies to language as well. So, you know, your insistence on being polite and, respecting other people, those are actually skills the students, not because of design, but because of lack of competence, students sometimes, you know, are unable to express themselves properly in these areas. So I believe this would be a great opportunity for our students to, you know, learn a lot from your presentation, and they would themselves understand where they lack, and they might perhaps improve themselves and be able to, you know, communicate better when they come back to the campus, to the physical campus, so to say. Thank you, Mallika.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Ma'am, may we now proceed with the questions? Anag, may we have your question, please?
Good afternoon, ma'am. My name is Anag Mishra, and my question is that what is the difference between a general and a professional communication?
Okay, ma'am, thank you so much for your question, dear. Basically, when we talk about general communication, it is supposed to be, you know, informal. It is supposed to be personal. It is supposed to be, you know, subjective. And most of the time, it is supposed to be based on imagination as well. But as contrary to this, when we talk about professional communication, it is supposed to be quite formal, okay? It is supposed to be impersonal. And as I told you during my presentation also, that you are supposed to go for a purpose. Why? Because every time it is supposed to be purpose-oriented, where you are going to address the specific audience, right? When you talk about general communication, you can talk to anybody. You're talking to your friends, you're talking to your parents, you're talking to your sibling, anybody. Okay, but when we talk about professional communication, every time you are interacting with a specific audience, so you need to be thoroughly prepared. Okay, Beta?
Thank you, ma'am. Now, can we have Saida Abdi with her question, please? Saida.
What is the criterion for evaluating an effective speaker?
If you talk about my opinion, basically, like as we judge our students, okay, whenever you speak, basically, we try to judge you on multiple criteria, okay? There are multiple categories, rather, but basically, we divide it into four parts, right? We go for content, how well prepared you are, okay, your clarity of thought and expression. Then we see your confidence level. whether you are able to express yourself in a confident way or not. Okay. At the same time, we also, you know, notice your articulation part. So basically, if you talk about my views, I judge my students on the basis of their content, their clarity, their confidence level, and of course, the articulation part. Okay.
Akriti, may we have your question now?
Good afternoon, ma'am. I am Akriti Marwa, student of BA fifth semester. My question is, what is interpersonal communication?
Okay, beta. Very good question, Radhar. Now, if you talk about interpersonal communication, this is supposed to be the interaction between two or more people. You talk about your classroom situation, you talk about any meeting, you talk about any group discussion. Every time it is supposed to be interpersonal communication. Basically, this is supposed to be the face-to-face communication. It is a direct communication, okay? Where you can get the instant feedback. Why? Because you can, you can read the non-verbal cues. You can read the body language of your audience. Why? Because you are supposed to be in close physical proximity. Okay. So as soon as you discuss some policy, you can see how your audience react, and then accordingly you can change your strategy. So this is supposed to be very beneficial for anyone if you go for interpersonal communication or the direct communication. Okay, beta.
Amrisha. Your question.
Yes. Good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm Amrita Dusia of BA Semester 5. I would like to ask, ma'am, how can I be more confident while presenting my ideas?
Beta, whenever you present your ideas, take my words. First of all, you need to be thoroughly prepared. Practice it more and more. Okay? Just try to collect the material from different sources. Practice it again and again. Just try to rehearse in front of the mirror, okay? And as soon as you face the audience, as I have already told you, you need to stay cool and calm. Don't panic. Even if you fail to satisfy the audience, even if there is something that you are not aware of, then also you are supposed to stay calm, okay? So once you are confident, once you are clear in your concept, this will definitely help you out to be, to present your ideas in front of the audience in an effective way, okay?
Nikita, all right, she isn't here, Nikita says, and I address a question to you, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am. As you said, as soon as we grow up, we need to express. But in the current Indian scenario, what is the best way to communicate our feelings without hurting someone else's views and ideologies?
As I have already told you, and I have been emphasizing throughout my presentation, that you are supposed to be very polite in your approach. You're supposed to be very humble in your approach. Even if you don't agree with somebody's view, you are supposed to put forward your ideas in a dignified way, okay? Without hurting the sentiments of other people. So by the time, once you, speak with a positive mindset, it will always help you out. Even if you are going to speak against somebody, or maybe even if you don't agree with that person's opinion, but if you are having a positive mindset, if you are having a friendly tone, if you are dignified in your ways, definitely you can put forward your ideas in front of the people. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am, for addressing all the queries of the students. I'm sure they have greatly benefited, and they will, this learning is something that is going to remain with them for a very long time. Now, Rupal, may I invite you for the word of thanks?
Thank you, ma'am. Gratitude unlocks the fullness of life. It turns what we have into enough and more. It turns denial into acceptance and confusion into clarity. I place on record my deep sense of gratitude to Dr. Tripathi. Ma'am, you have sown the seeds of awareness in us and reshaped our understanding of the whole concept. Thank you for sparing your precious time. We look forward to another thought-provoking session with you once the college reopens. We are indebted to Ms. Vikaji, President, Managing Committee, for making it possible for us to conduct the event. We are grateful to Professor Pandey, Manager Secretary, Managing Committee, for her constant support in making the event possible. We are thankful to Dr. Chaturvedi, Principal, Avadh Girls Degree College, for her help and guidance in all our events. I would like to thank Dr. Krishna, for her untiring efforts in initiating, molding, and working to make the event possible. I offer my sincere thanks to Dr. Katiyar for always being our support system. I distinctly thank Ma'am D. Sharma for conducting the event. I'm delighted to thank Ma'am A. Sharma for moderating the session. I'm pleased to thank Ma'am Bhatnagar for the technical assistance in the session. I take this opportunity to thank all the faculty members from our and also from other colleges for taking out time and staying with us throughout the session. Without a disciplined and extremely engaged audience, an event cannot be successful. Thank you to all the students for making the event successful. Now, I would like to request everyone to please switch on their cameras for the group picture. Thank you.